And have the pleasure now to listen to Mr. Colin Duke from the European Quality Assurance Register, who will make a presentation about common principles, different approaches, the European Quality Assurance landscape. Mr. Duke, you have the floor.
Well, thank you very much to Mr. Panzau for the kind introduction, and also thank you very much to the University of Bucharest for the kind invitation to speak at that seminar today. As one comment I have to make about my name, because we were discussing Rado's name earlier today. Well, my name is even only the second name in my passport, and I'm not using the first name in my passport at all, so I'm not so so picky what's written in my passport. So I was asked to speak a bit about the internal and external quality assurance landscape in Europe and give a bit of an overview of what's happening in the countries. And then I'm going to present briefly the the European instruments for quality assurance that Adam has already mentioned earlier, but speak a bit more in detail about that, and then finally I also want to say some words about learning outcomes. But of course, glad to hurry up a bit to get us back into the schedule as well. I'm starting with external quality assurance in Europe, and then go back to internal quality assurance afterwards. We look about external quality assurance system in the different 47 countries that are part of the Bologna process, there are a lot of different motivations why external quality assurance actually is being undertaken. And in some places it's mostly for the reason of accountability, ensuring that institutions are accountable about their work to the public, to the government, to the taxpayers. So in that way it's also sometimes a bit linked to the supervisory function of the state and the government, or it's about consumer protection, trying to protect the interests of students, or maybe trying to protect the interests of the labor market as a place where students go afterwards. Or it can also be mostly for the purpose of assisting universities to develop and enhance their quality, so it can be more enhancing that and less focused on accountability. Then, of course, in different countries there are different contexts. I mean, there's small and big higher education systems, there are different political histories, and there are different traditional roles and positions of higher education institutions. I mean, in some countries, institutions were traditionally very autonomous in their work, and there was not traditionally much supervision at all from the outside. And then in other countries, there was a very close state supervision, or very detailed external steering traditionally. And then, of course, there are different institutional profiles and the differences between the comprehensive and more specialized universities in Romania were explained, and then in other countries they are traditional research oriented universities or more professionally oriented colleges. So all these different contexts and motivations for external quality assurance lead to very different approaches that are implemented in the different countries in Europe. I mean, there are some countries that mostly do program accreditation, so they have an external accreditation system where every study program has to be accredited. That's, for instance, in the Netherlands or in Denmark and Spain. Or there are countries where there's mostly an institutional accreditation system where whole universities or colleges are accredited, like in Norway, or their institutional audit systems, like in Finland, which we'll show you hear about later, or in the United Kingdom. Then there are also combined approaches, like For instance, Poland has a system where every institution has to be accredited and every program has to be accredited, like in Romania as well. Or there are alternative approaches like Germany, where a new system has been put up, put in place where the, well, by default every program has to be accredited, except for the university achieves so-called institutional accreditation, which in a way says that university has there's sufficient confidence in the university's own quality assurance system, so the programs themselves don't have to be accredited anymore. And then, last but not least, there are also countries where you have different external quality assurance regimes for different subsectors. For instance, in Austria, where you have public universities, private universities, and university colleges, and each of these three subsectors has completely different rules for external quality assurance. And I think in a way this diverse landscape in external quality assurance also influences the internal quality assurance landscape to some extent. And there can also be different motivations for universities to set up an internal quality assurance system. For instance, you could contrast intrinsic and extrinsic motivations. I mean, it could be the university that sets up an internal quality assurance system of its own accord because it thinks it's a helpful measure to improve its work and to develop its quality. Or there could be a more extrinsic motivation if the university is basically driven by external demands, for instance by the external quality assurance system that might require the university to set up an internal quality assurance system. And then again, also in internal quality assurance, there are different approaches. I mean, there can be a completely self-developed approach of the university. Some universities might rely on existing generic models like ISO, in order to get an ISO certification. Or there might be specific national frameworks and requirements for internal quality assurance of universities. And then last but not least, there are also different scopes. I mean, in some cases, the internal quality assurance system is holistic, covers everything, all of the work of the university. In some cases, it might only cover research, and in some cases, it might only cover teaching and education, or it might only cover student services or administration. Let's skip that. So, looking at all this. My jacket is quite warm next to this projector. looking at this diversity of quality assurance in Europe, now talking about the European standards and guidelines for quality assurance, one might ask, isn't that a bit square in the circle, trying to come up with standards valid for all Europe in looking at this diversity? So what are these? What are these European standards and guidelines that have been referred to before? One of the main characteristics is that they have not been simply developed by the government or decided by ministers. But they have been decided by ministers based on a proposal prepared jointly by the key stakeholders in higher education. So ministers have asked quality assurance agencies, higher education institutions and students to sit together and prepare a proposal for standards and guidelines for quality assurance in Europe. And only afterwards they were finally agreed by the ministers, but in a way the main ownership of this standards is by the stakeholders and not by the government. And then they are coming back to the squaring the circle. The European standards and guidelines are maybe not really what one would expect when hearing the word standards, but in a way they are more like a set of common principles and reference points for quality assurance. So they are not detailed norms or detailed procedures. They don't tell in detail what has to be done. They don't tell in detail, there has to be accreditation or audit, or there has to be quality assurance at institutional level or program level, but they are far more generic in setting some principles for quality assurance. So how do they, before getting into some of the most important principles, how do they, what are the core values? I mean, on the one hand, what they stress very much, these standards and guidelines, is the central responsibility of higher education institutions for their quality. So one of the first things they say is that universities themselves will always be responsible for ensuring the quality of their study programs and their qualifications. And they also stress very much the cooperation of stakeholders in the quality assurance process, to which I will get back afterwards. And finally, also that maybe the two ends of the scale in terms of the possible objectives, accountability versus improvement, always have to be balanced in some way. In quite a similar way, there always needs to be a balance of the four main goals in education that were cited before. There also should always be a balance between accountability and improvement, and it should never be only about accountability, and it should never be only about improvement without any regard to accountability at all. Then European standards and guidelines have three parts. So there are one part that's addressing internal quality assurance by the higher education institutions. They have a second part addressing external quality assurance of higher education, and then they have a third part addressing external quality assurance agencies in more in an organizational sense. And these three parts build up on each other, so every part first and foremost refers to the underlying part, so that again goes back to this principle of the central responsibility of higher education institutions, and the way it says that external quality assurance can't work without sufficient support and without sufficient basis in terms of internal quality assurance activities in the university. So it can only build up on that, but external quality assurance can never replace the work of institutions themselves. So I mentioned three I find very important principles in the European standards and guidelines that we find on, not only in one of the chapters, but in different chapters. One being transparency as a general term. I mean, a lot of the European standards and guidance is about having predefined and publicly available procedures and criteria for quality assurance. So that goes from saying that universities should have in place a policy for internal quality assurance until saying that agencies should be using procedures and criteria that are predefined and publicly available, so that every institution knows what's going to happen and what the agency is going to look into. Then it's also about publication of quality assurance results, and also about transparency in terms of criteria and when it comes to student assessment, for instance. So that also students should be able to know in advance what criteria and what reference point they are going to be assessed against. The second principle that I already mentioned before about the involvement of stakeholders, I just want to mention a few words why it is, I think, important to have an active involvement of the different stakeholders at all levels. And I think in a way it goes back to the question, what is quality in higher education? Because if you ask what is quality of higher education, you might hear a lot of different responses depending on who you ask. And university leadership might have one understanding, students might have another understanding, governments might have a different understanding, and the labor market might have, again, a different understanding of what's good higher education, what is a good study program. And in a way, the principle is to say, not to try to come up with a universal definition of good higher education, because that would probably take us a few years to discuss, and be questionable or whether it would be possible to agree, but rather than that, involve the different parties that have a legitimate interest at all the different levels. So involve students, involve the labor market, involve academics when